Greetings, people. Paul Muckle here. Today is August 22nd, 2013, at 2:01 p.m. Eastern Time. People, I just came home from court, and I must say I'm so freaking disappointed. Nothing happened in court today, people. They postponed it again, as usual. As usual, people. Okay. Every time I go to court and they know the case is about to be dismissed, the DA would pull a stunt. Right, my Rara? And people, this is my anger. I came from court, I was so angry. I was so angry. Before the judge even finished speaking, I turned and walked away. I head straight for the door. Then I stopped because my attorney came to me to speak to me. I was so pissed because people, you know what happened? First, they did the first call, right? One day, give an excuse. Oh, can we have a second call? Then they did the second call. Another DA came up and said, oh, Your Honor, the DA had a medical emergency and he couldn't make it. So we asked for a postponement. And people, yes, my Rara. People, y'all call me evil all y'all want. But I don't trust that DA. He lied. Because people, the case was going to be dismissed today. I know for a fact the case was going to be dismissed today. Because like my friend Benizuel said, it's a conspiracy. So the DA pulled a stunt and lied and say he had a medical emergency so that the judge won't hear my case. Well, you know, some people, you call me evil. I hope, I pray to my God. I pray that that DA, that whoever it is that he lied on, I hope they die. I swear to you, I hope your family member die. DA, I don't know if your name is Connelly or whoever you are. But I hope your family member die. You know why? Because you shouldn't lie. You shouldn't use a family member and lie and say you have a family emergency to keep justice from me. So I could take this freaking bracelet off my freaking leg. Okay? So I could take this shit off my freaking leg. Okay? That's what I want. Okay? You want to deny me justice so that I want to take this shit off my leg. So every time we go to court, you always have an excuse. I always have a freaking excuse, but guess what? This time, your time has come. This ain't no threat. This ain't no intimidation. I'm not physically threatening you. I'm using my God, the sun, and the elements to threaten you. That I hope your family member die. I don't give a damn who call me evil. What you all are doing to me is evil. I can't freaking sleep at night because this freaking bracelet on my leg, it is so freaking sensitive that if I touch it the wrong way when I'm sleeping, it's gonna go off. And they're gonna call me, wake me up and say, Paul Muckle, why are you messing with your bracelet? Turn yourself in tomorrow. Every freaking time, people. Okay, so guess what? The more you all delay, I hope you all family member die. I don't give a freak who wanna call me evil. My children are suffering too. My children, do you think my children don't suffer knowing what you all are doing to me? Huh? My family, do you think my mother suffers every time I have to call her and say, Mommy, I'm about to go to jail? They suffer. My family members suffer knowing what you are evil, racist bastards in the federal court in Boston and the BMC court in Boston and the DA after doing to me. Y'all are racist. Y'all are some racist mother effers, and I hope your family member die. DA, I pray to God that your family member die so you will stop using them as excuse to deny me justice. Okay, now people, I'm about to show you all. I just got some evidence from them people. The evidence that they claim that I threatened this weasel attorney. I'm about to listen to it right now. And then when I finish listening to it, I'm going to add it to this video to show you all what they're trying to charge me with. It is so loud in my attorney. I didn't hear the tape yet. It's a voicemail they say I left in 2010 for the weasel attorney. But in my attorney was laughing. My attorney said, Paul, that tape helps you. Because people in that tape, you know what I say in that tape? I'm gonna get a rainbow today too. I'm gonna get my rainbow, people. Watch. Watch me get a rainbow today, okay? At least I'm hoping for one. I think I'm gonna get a rainbow today, okay? Anyway, the point being, people, is that they're trying to deny me justice by staying away from the court. This case is over a year old. I got locked up May 1st, 2012. Today's August 22nd, 2013, and nothing has happened yet. Nothing. Because the DA keep running away, keep making excuses, keep getting the case delayed. But guess what? I hope your family member die. die because you know why? You use them and say you had a family emergency, so you deny me justice. So guess what? I'll deny you justice. I hope your family member die. I don't give a freak who want to call me evil. Evil bastard. You're destroying your career for this weasel because you're going to jail. Every single one of you who was participated in this conspiracy against me, every one of you who took part in the conspiracy against me, all of you are going to prison. That's a threat. That's why y'all charged me with, because I told this weasel he's going to prison, and y'all say it's a threat, and y'all charged me. People, they charged me with making threats because I told this weasel that there's a prison cell waiting for him in Suffolk County Jail. That's what they're charging me with. Wait till y'all hear the tape. So now y'all gonna charge me with, now I hope y'all family member die. Charge me with that too. I'm gonna pray to God that he kill y'all family member for y'all denying me justice. Charge me with that too. Call it intimidation of a witness. I'm intimidating y'all with the weather. I'm intimidating y'all with God. So come on, lock me up for praying that y'all family member die. Since y'all wanna lie on them and say that y'all have an emergency, I hope they die, y'all bastard, you all. See y'all in court next Thursday. Hey people, I am back. And guess what? I got my rainbow. Only that, this rainbow wasn't in the sky. The rainbow is in the document in the desk that my attorney handed to me today, people. What am I worried about? It does not matter if they dismiss the case, people. Because, people, what I'm about to show you, it's astounding. People, I want to cry, but I have to laugh because it's a joke. People, wait until you all hear the voicemails that these people are accusing me of making, that are threatening. And, people, do you remember I showed you all this document before, right? Where the federal marshal wrote this report saying, on 4-6-2012, Muckle sent a threatening voicemail as a follow-up to his threatening emails to the law firm of That's Just in Boston, Mass. The voicemail contained numerous serious, direct, and actionable threats. The threats are not directed at any federal protectee. Okay? People, mark those words about the threats, right? Numerous serious, direct, and actionable threats. Okay? Now, remember, I've been accused of threatening to kill, harassment, wiretapping, and leaving threatening voicemails. My friends, I want you to listen to these voicemails, right? And you be the judge, and you tell me in here where you find any serious, direct, and actionable threats. Threats that I made that a jury would convict me for and send me to prison. Okay? Here we go, the first one. I'm gonna bleep out the attorney's name and call him by his real name, okay? Alright, so here we go, the first one. Weasel.
Mr. Paul Muckle, I'm leaving this message for you. I just want you to know I don't like you. I never liked you. From the first time I know about you, I never liked you. You're a cocky, arrogant bastard. I want to tell you something right now. The revolution is coming to America. When it comes, I'm coming to look for you. Okay? I'm sending the soldiers to look for you. You're going to be in prison. Okay? You're going to be locked up in prison, especially for your crimes against the American people.
Weasel.
You're a criminal. Okay? You have worked for Wall Street, for Wall Street banks, trying to take my home. Trying to fuck the American people for Wall Street, for these foreign banks. I just want you to know I don't like you. I never liked you. And when the revolution comes, we coming to get you. Okay, we coming to get you, Sean.
Weasel.
Personally, we coming to get you. Okay, just so you know. You can take this as a threat. You can give it to the FBI. I don't give a damn who you give it to. Okay? But I'm telling you something. When the revolution comes to America, you going to be in prison for siding with these Wall Street cats against the American people. You are a traitor. And traitors going to be in prison. And you're going to be one of them. So just record this message all you want. But when the revolution comes to America, you are going to be one of my first person I put in prison personally, okay? My word, there's a cell in Suffolk County Jail. There's a cell in Suffolk County waiting for you, okay? Remember that. There's a cell in the county jail waiting for you for your crimes against the people of America for selling with Wall Street. I do not like you. Know that. Okay? All right.
So, people, do you all hear that? I'm saying to this guy that there's a prison cell waiting for him in Suffolk County Jail for his crimes against the American people, that he's a traitor. I'm saying when the revolution starts, I'm sending the soldiers. I said me personally, and I'm sending the soldiers to get him. People, do you know what the allegations are? They say these threats have put the weasel in fear of bodily harm. That I have put him in fear, that he's in fear of his life because of this voicemail. That's the allegation in the report. That this voicemail put him in fear of his life. Now, people, if you're not doing any wrong, if you haven't committed any crime, why would you be in fear of your life if a revolution is coming to America and the soldiers, and we're talking about prison, okay? We're talking about a government jail. We're here to be put, so it's going to be a government action, ain't it? It's going to be a people's action. Not some overseas terrorist. We're talking about a revolution by the American people for justice against Wall Street. So, people, what jury do you all believe will convict me for leaving this voicemail? What can they say? Oh, it's harassment? Was it intent to cause bodily harm and injury, to put him in fear of death? No. It was a warning to him that when the revolution comes, he's going to prison for his crimes against the American people. And now his crimes against Paul Merkel. And his crimes are, he is defending Wall Street against American people. But people, let me let you all hear two more voicemails. Then I'm going to show you all some of the emails that they talk about was so threatening. Okay, my friends, here goes another voicemail. Weasel.
This is Paul Merkel. I just received a letter, one certified and one paying letter from Orlando Moran, threatening that you they're being hired by Wells Fargo to start foreclosure proceeding on our property. I gave you guys a letter of demand, and without a court order, they're not supposed to be contacting us. Remember, that was the whole thing. You're not supposed to be contacting us directly. So I would like for you to call me back on this matter, 774-274-8244. And ask the client not to be sending me these notices unless you have a court order to come to foreclose on my property. I'd appreciate that, please. Okay, thank you, bye.
So, people, that's another voicemail that I left. I'm asking this guy to ask his people to stop harassing me. Stop sending me harassing letters. Stop trying to intimidate me and trying to scheme into my house. That's what I'm asking him. I'm asking him to, please ask him to stop it. I asked him to call me back on the matter. The voice is muffled, so you may not understand everything I say, but I'm asking him to call me back on the matter. People, they call that harassment and threats. Do you all hear that? Do I need to play it again? You all could rewind the video. But clearly, they're not threats or harassment in this voicemail. I'm asking the guy to please ask those attorneys to stop calling and harassing me. Stop sending me harassing letters and threatening me about eviction and foreclosure when they didn't have a court order to do so. So I'm telling him, unless you have a court order, please stop doing it unless you have a court order to foreclose. Then send me notices, call me or whatever, but don't do it until you get that. But they call this harassment and intimidation. Actually, people, I forget the other part too. Intimidation of a witness. They say this is intimidation of a witness also. That was the other charge. So the first voicemail just play, and this one, they call it intimidation of a witness, harassment, and making threats to kill. Okay? So this is the third voicemail now.
Hey, Mr. Weaver. Again. I just made a couple of phone calls, and you're very incorrect with what you said. I got to talk with the appeals court clerk, and your client got defaulted. FC Mortgage got defaulted by the court. Okay, so FC Mortgage owned the property. They got defaulted, so until the appeals court come back, you have no authority to even send me any more testimony. Mr.
Weasel.
Can you please have your client not even do this anymore? Because next time I'm not gonna file a lawsuit. It's harassment. Okay, you are trying to intimidate me. It's not gonna work. Okay. Your client defaulted, FC Mortgage defaulted, you never answered to the complaint or the appeal. Therefore, you have no authority to foreclose my property, and I would ask that you stop, have your client stop, because this is today's what? Thursday. And if they write me any more correspondence, I'm going to turn it into a lawsuit. And I'm serious. I don't like to be threatened or harassed. And I know that's what y'all do. Y'all trying to harass me. Okay? The Attorney General doesn't have the authority to give you authority because you defaulted in the federal court. So if you want to discuss this more, you can call me. But I already know next time I'm gonna file a suit against your client and you for intimidation and harassment. Thank you.
So people, y'all hear that right there? I'm telling him to ask his client to please stop harassing and intimidating me. Stop threatening me. Stop sending me this correspondence until you get a ruling from the court because your client defaulted. People, SG Mortgage. You know who SG Mortgage is, people? I'm going to share it. It's in the email, people. People, it is so powerful. This letter is so powerful. And all Americans and British people, even Canadians and Australians, y'all really need to. Everybody, y'all need to have patience with me, please. And please follow somebody. I'm going to read y'all somebody's email because it's powerful. I'm going to show y'all why they set me up. Okay, and people, before I get forward, let me say this about the federal marshal, John Lemmy and Matthew Dumas, the federal marshal that helped set me up, who befriended me. And I've said some terrible things about them, and I said it out of anger. And this is not no cop-out, what I'm about to say. It's not a cop-out. I'm speaking this from my heart, because I have to face reality. And people, no, and honestly, those two federal marshals, they protected me the best the way they could have. Because when they came to me that night, people, it was such a relief. Because I really wanted someone from my authority to come and speak to me, so I could let them know that I don't mean nobody, no threat, and no harm, that I'm just speaking about spiritual things. And when they came, it was an answer to my prayer. I prayed for someone to come. So when they came, it was like divine to me. And people, after they befriended me, they told me honestly, that same night, they said, honestly, Paul, what you're saying, we like what you're saying, but please, do us a favor, we have a job to do. Make our job easy for us, please. Whatever you do, do not threaten Judge Woodlock. Do not threaten Judge Woodlock, any judge in the federal court. Just do us that favor, okay? And when you come to the federal court, don't resist. Let them search you and let them escort you. Just do us that favor. It will be good on your benefit if you do that. And you will help us also because we like you and we can't harm you. Let this out to me, people, honestly. He said, so whatever you do, keep speaking. Keep making your videos, but do not threaten Judge Woodlock. And do not threaten the weasel either. Do not threaten him because they're going to set you up. They're waiting for you. They're waiting to pounce on you. The federal marshal told me that. He said they're waiting for you to say something so they could come and get you. And they said to me, plain out, these people will kill you. Okay, they will kill you. They're not playing. They will kill you. And I said, what about Obama? Can I speak about Obama? He said, oh, you could speak about Obama, but because he's not our charge. But we're in charge of the federal judges, and we have a job to do. And please just make our job easy for us. And then people, a couple of times they came back and saw me. And they said to me, each time they come, they say, Paul, we came, I said, why you come for to arrest me? Other joke. And they said, no, we came for justice and we came for the law. They say, you are justice, Paul. You justice. And they are the law. We came for both of you because we have a job to do. And we can't let any harm come to you. Keep doing what you're doing. Just don't threaten the federal judge and this guy. But people all the while the federal marshal were telling me that, they were going behind my back and setting me up for the weasel and the federal judge. When they took me between those two trees and did that lynching on me, it wasn't for them. It wasn't for their own pleasure. They did it because someone asked them to do it. Because they didn't want to seem like they were taking my side. I understand that. They did it for me because now I could use it against them. Not the federal marshal, but against whoever sent them. Because people, why did the federal marshal came to see me? Because I was accused of threatening a federal judge. Who the federal judge? Honorable Judge Woodlock. So he sent, the federal marshal came on behalf of him. Okay, so whatever they did is on behalf of him. Okay? So they protected me, people, because if it wasn't for them, maybe I would have set a threat to the federal judge. I perhaps would have done it out of anger or out of mischief. But it wasn't going to be a serious threat, people, because none of my threats, none of my so-called threats was serious. It was all with the weather. And I probably would have sent my threat with the weather and with God. And then they took another threat and arrested me. But the federal marshal warned me not to do that. And I took the advice and I didn't do it. That's why there was never any evidence. So they helped me. They prevented me from going over the cliff because I already told them I was going to go over the cliff. I told them, people, I sent them emails saying, I'm going to deliberately go over the cliff to see if you are going to stop me. I told them that. I told them I'm going to deliberately do it to force the government into submission and to see if they're going to stop me. So they prevented me by telling me, do not do it, Paul. So I honor them for that and I'm angry at them for doing that thing to me between those two trees that may force me to sing Old Pirate Yes the Rabbi, Soul Light to the Merchant Ship. I'm angry at them for that, but I understand that they did it to protect me. Because if it wasn't, it wasn't them, it would have been others. And these others wouldn't have been so kind to me. They would not keep the banksters from me for so long. So I forgive Matthew and I forgive John. Even if I was to sue them, it will not be because I want to punish them. It will be to get the truth out. So, but otherwise, I have no animosity towards them because they saved me. They did. Even though they set me up, they still saved me at the same time. You know, so they use their set, you know, their fox. You know, they can use a destructive power for good and for evil. And they are counterbalanced in an orderly universe. So that's what the cops are for. The feds are a counterbalance in an orderly universe. They can use a destructive power for good and for evil. And that's what they did. That's what the federal marshal did, for good and evil. But they did help me, so I honor them for that. So anyway now, you are hearing voicemails. The federal marshal, they set me up, but at the same time, they freed me. They say I never threatened the judge. They wrote a very good report about me. But at the same time, they lied and said I threatened the weasel. So you see, a double standard. So it was, like I said, they say they came for the law and they came for justice. And that's what they did. So anyway, people, I'm going to show you our SD Mortgage now that own my property. These emails, people, wow. Powerful emails, people. I'm going to show you all some of the emails, I just a few experts that I wrote that they charged me with threatening this judge, okay? Dear Weasel and Weasel, this email is to notify you that on Saturday, April 3rd, 2010, I received a judge ruling in my mortgage fraud claim granting you summary judgment. It was so funny watching your grins when you got that conference call from the judge on Wednesday telling you all that the deed was done. One of you was heard saying about me I wish I can see his face when he opened the package. Then all three of you laughed. Well, at least that's how the story was related to me. So people, I'm just saying, I'm seeing like a vision, people, of when the judge told him that he was against me. Because people, they tried to give me all kind of deals to accept a loan. Because as you all know, I sue all the banks. And on behalf of all the people, and they were trying to force me into a settlement. And they offered me all kind of bribery, and I refused all the offers. So the judge ended up getting frustrated at me, and he ruled against me and accused my mother of committing fraud, when he know damn well my mother never committed no fraud. But to punish me for standing up for the American people, he called my mother a liar and a thief, basically. So I wrote this letter, and so I'm showing them my vision of what I see on their faces when the judge told them that he ruled against me. So these things tend to get romanticized by the time the flies on the wall get to me. Well, guess what? Initially, when I first read the lame opinion, I panicked. But then my guide gave me a quick slap in the face to bring me back to reality. Then the celebrating began. It is the day I have long awaited. Please find attached my response to the judge's grossly erroneous ruling. His findings are clearly deficient and will no doubt left the reviewer wondering what type of medication the judge was on when he wrote it. That judge disrespected my mother and basically called her a thief and a fraudster. I promise you all that his blatant disrespect and disregard and disrespect to my black African empress will not go unchallenged. I am going to use a lot to tear him down from off that high horse he sat on when he knowingly and intentionally falsely accused my mother of lying and committing mortgage fraud because he was not man enough to take on her uneducated son before a jury. Because people, the judge basically tried to diss me in his opinion, calling me up my thing, rambling, and you know, messianic, and he basically tried to disrespect me, my writing, the way I wrote, in his opinion. So I'm saying he wouldn't let the case go to the people, he wouldn't let the case go to the jury. He denied me a jury trial and gave my house to the banksters. So I wrote this letter. Okay, so, and he accused my mother of committing fraud and lying when he know for a fact from his own observation when the case began, he said the banks committed the fraud. But because I refused to take the banks offer now, he switched over and said my mother lied and my mother committed fraud and my mother lied to get me a house. And I rah. So I am going to use the law to tear him down from off that high horse he sat on when he knowingly and intentionally falsely accused my mother of lying and committing mortgage fraud because he was not man enough to take on her uneducated son before jury. His words will get him disbarred. I will send our Sharpton and Justice Jackson to do it for me. Bright and feisty. How dare him? Please find my response to that instrument of corruption that the judge ordered and signed on March 31st, 2010. You touched my children home and suffered the consequences. I have nothing to lose by taking you on from now until eternity. Can you brag of that same luxury? Let's play chess. Your move. The letter of intent to sue you is attached. As a matter of fact, as soon as I file my appeal, I will initiate suits against your firms. Time to put you guys away so I can concentrate on your true master, the Rothschild dynasty. I'm going to bring them down for mortgage and securities fraud. Read the letter. It is all in there. Respectfully yours until you make any wrong moves. Paul L. Merkel, a real revolutionary. So people, where's the threat? See my threat, people? Lawsuit. The letter of intent to sue. That's my threat. I threaten to sue them, people. And they call this a threat to do bodily harm, to put him in fear of his life, emotional duress and anguish. This is what they're going to put before a jury to convict me. and terror charges. So now, people, let me show you a few excerpts of the letter of intent. This is very important for the simple fact that it shows you all how Rothschild is connected to the collapse of the American economy on September 15, 2008. It also, people, I'm going to show you all, people, why I am so angry at this judge. Because, people, and may my Lord God forgive me, and I don't care if they don't come after me for this, people, I don't care if they come after me, because, people, like I said, death means nothing to me anymore. It doesn't. I have already surrendered my life to death. I've poured up my soul unto death already. So it means nothing to me. Imprisonment, it hurts, but I just got to grin and bear it. If I saw, I saw. So I'm going to speak out because I know something powerful is in the sky watching over me. I know it for a fact. So I'm not gonna fear any man, I'm gonna speak. And this judge had the audacity, people, to knowingly and intentionally lie on my mother. In his opinion, said my mother committed fraud and lied on her loan application about employment. When he seen the documents and the credit report that show my mother was on Social Security benefit at the time when she co-signed for me. She didn't put no income because they told her, you don't need income. You have perfect credit, and that's all we need, perfect credit. It's all in the documents. Credit, credit, credit. Oh, my mom have perfect credit. It's there. But her credit report shows that the bank knew she was on Social Security benefit, and that the bank knew that my mother was not employed, and that the banks knowingly and intentionally falsified my mom's income. Because with the bank signature and the documents, the bank's underwriter signatures, increasing the income of my mother. My mother was making $350 a month on Social Security benefit. And people, and the loan document, it said my mother make $9,840 a month, plus another $1,800 from rental property and stuff like that. And my mother have all these assets. And it's a bank signature and the underwriter signature and these documents. And the judge had it before him. He had them. Because I gave it to him. And who gave it to me? The banks themselves. So they couldn't say it was me who made those documents. But yet he still said my mother committed fraud and lied. So he looked down onto us. So now, when I got arrested at Memphis for making threats to him and to the weasel, and they saw my house on May 2nd, while I was in the prison cell, I prayed to my God. I said, my Lord, despite their denial that this federal judge had nothing to do with this, I know he had a lot to do with it. He's the chief amongst them. And the weasel also. Don't kill them, my Lord. Don't hurt them, please. Hurt the one they love. Because this guy hurt me when he spoke about my mother. Knowingly and intentionally lied on my mother. And I asked my Lord, hurt his mother. Hurt his father. Or the one he loved. But don't hurt him. Kill them, but don't kill him. Kill them, but don't kill him. And then when I came with the prison people, they sold my house. My second, I came with the prison, and I sued them. And they took the case to the same judge. And come to find out, people, how is my God so great? People, my God killed someone near and dear to this judge. But it wasn't just anyone he killed. It was someone who had a financial interest with these banks that the judges gave my home to. Someone close to connected to this judge. I don't know if it's mother, father, was someone closely connected to him, had a financial interest with the banks while the bank, while this judge was presiding over the case. Okay, now y'all might argue and say, well, the judge didn't have to know that they had it. Of course he didn't have to know. But did he make any efforts to know? He's not under any obligation, but how are we going to know? Did he know? Is he going to tell us he knew? So the point being, people, the one he loved died in the same month. The same day they locked me up. I don't know if it was the same day or within 2 weeks or whenever. But the same May they locked me up. His loved one died. And it so happened that that loved one was heavily invested in the same banks that he gave my home to. So when I sued him again for locking me up and for selling my house while I was locked up, the weasel, playing smart but not being clever, removed the case from the state court down to the federal court, hoping that the same judge will take the case and throw it out in their favor again. So the judge, by divine powers, people, because he could have kept it a secret, no one would have ever known. So he had to be divine. He admitted that because someone in his family died in May of 2012, he's about to settle the estate and therefore had to recuse himself from the case. Now people, isn't this divine? How is it people in the same me that I was locked up for this judge disrespecting my mother, calling her a liar and a cheat and a fraudster, committing fraud and lying to get me a home, even though the evidence was contrary to his ruling? How is it that someone in his family, close to him, was heavily invested in the same banks who he ruled in favor of, and now he have inherited a financial interest with these banks? So guess what this means, people? This means that this federal judge have benefited financially from the sale of my home on May 2nd, 2012. He has benefited financially from the sale of my home. Isn't that improper? That's justice, people. That's American justice. So when I say stuff out of anger, you all cannot blame me, because at least I'm not picking up guns. I'm not picking up weapons. I'm using my mouth.
Oh, and my Lord.
I'm beseeching my Lord. Okay? So give me some credit that I have not gone over the top, because you all have seen the evidence so far of what these people have done to me. Give me some credit that I have not gone off the top and pick up arms, because the Constitution will back me up. The Constitution will back me up if I was true to do that, because of the crimes these people have committed against me. And this is the government, so I cannot go and complain to anyone. Eric Holder, his office know what's going on, because they've seen the reports. Barack Obama was part of my lawsuit. They know what's going on. Are they telling these people to leave me alone? So where can I turn to, people? And be honest, who can I turn to? I'm not going to pick up arms, because I did not come to spill anyone's blood. So I turn to my mouth and to my God, the one I believe in, the sun and in the universe, the stars and the moons. I turn to them for power, for an empowerment. And I turn to my friends and YouTube. I turn to them for strength and empowerment. And I fight. That's my fight. A spiritual battle. I never come to fight flesh and blood, but spiritual wickedness in high and low places. So, the email, okay? That's why I said about the judge. And I was right. My God had brought him low. He should be disbarred. For not only because people, did he know his loved one had a financial interest with the bank? Who's to know? Is he ever going to admit it? Of course not. But the evidence speaks for itself. He had benefited financially in the sale of my property, which means his ruling should be overturned. Automatically, I should not have to ask for it. They should automatically overturn it and leave me alone in my home. But they know they are proceeding on his ruling. They are proceeding on that people to take my home from me and his order in which he had benefited financially. That's corruption. But that's not all. I was charged with making threats to him, with threatening him in a state court, even though the United States office refused to prosecute me, I take illegal action against me for what I said about him. This letter, people, they took this to the federal, the feds to prosecute me. The federal marshal took this letter to Eric Holder office to prosecute me, and they refused because they're not in here to prosecute me for. Okay? There's nothing here to prosecute me for. This is what they tried, people. This is what they're going to take before a jury to convict me for making threats to them, putting them in fear of their life. After this judge, okay, after this judge had benefited financially from the sale of my home in which his loved one had a financial interest while he was presiding over the case. Okay? So, he always had a financial interest because he have always been named a beneficiary. Of that I am certain, because my law would not have taken that loved one out of their way to prove his point that he is the Almighty. Jah, he is not God. Me the God. Tweet, 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 tweet. And people, do you all know that video? You all know that video I showed you all about the voice from the sun? Do you all know that video, people, is a part of my threats? People, that video is a part of my threat. I'm going to show it to you all. They are saying, I sent that video to them people. When I first uploaded that video in 2010, when I first discovered the voice, and I took it down because I knew y'all wouldn't take it seriously, so I uploaded the video before and I took it down because I knew y'all wouldn't take it seriously, y'all would take it with a hoax, so I took it down. And it so happened that I uploaded this video the other day, and now I got evidence today that they're going to use it. And people know, you know what now? Now the government going to have to authenticate this video. They're going to have to authenticate the voice because now they're saying I'm crazy. I'm going to show them, no, there's really a voice on here. The voice of the Almighty speaking, saying he's God. So now people, now you are going to know the truth that Paul McCartney didn't create this voice. Now you are going to see, it's going to be declared that this is the voice of the Almighty. So anyway, let me show you all a few more excerpts of the letter, and you all should be shocked, because I was shocked when I read this myself. Read what I discovered about the Rothschild. Okay, so people, this is what they're charging me with, okay? These are the crimes that your government are charging me with. I'm going to skip down to some pages. Okay, people. In part of my letter of intent to sue, right? It's very long. But this is the part, right? The grandest heist of them all. Okay, I'm going to tell you a brief thing, right? In the past 60 paragraphs, I basically told them what kind of fraud they committed against these people, right? Then I wrote here, is anyone still left wondering what just took place? The rebellion against capitalism began. That battle has been won, and they did not even see the broadside coming. There can be no defense from what just took place in the last 62 paragraphs. The Great Khan, which Wall Street and the London market pool and the world will go down in history as the greatest financial crime against humanity. But what Paul L. Merkel and the American people will do to Wall Street with this document will go down as the grandest heist of them all. The people are going to use the sly fox and his fat cat friend's own illegal arms agreement against them. Arms people is adjustable rate mortgages, okay? They call them arms. And adjustable rate mortgages are illegal, especially when you give them to anyone making under $10,000 a month, okay? And especially when you give them to minority homeowners. These are made for doctors and lawyers and financiers, people who make lumps of money. They're not for ordinary people. So they're predatory loans. That's what they really are. So they are illegal. So I'm saying that the people are going to use their own the terms of the arms agreement against them to identify them as construers of the pits and ourselves as the affected interest parties who were pushed into the pit, almost breaking our necks. Now we are entitled to relief and ownership of the security instrument securing those pits. Whosoever they get a pit shall fall into it. So people are basically calling mortgages a pit. The mortgages, the arm, adjustable rate mortgages, they are pits, because when you give these mortgages to low income and minority homeowners, you're basically digging a pit for them, because they are guaranteed to default and go into foreclosure. So you basically dig a pit for the people by giving them these mortgages. And whosoever digs a pit shall fall into it, because you toss into this pit. Now, the security instrument of this pit are the homes. So the home secure the mortgage. And since you dig the pit first, we should keep the home, and you could keep the mortgage all you want, but the home is ours. You could keep the promissory note, because a promise is a comfort to a fool. So keep the promissory note, but we're keeping our home and we're not gonna pay you. So people, I'm threatening them in this letter. I'm threatening them that if they keep messing with me, I'm gonna get 10 million Americans to sign letters of demand, demanding that these banks should remove the name from the title of their property. Because people, you have a right to do it. If you have a adjustable rate mortgage, you was given a predatory loan. The bank commits fraud against you, and the terms of those mortgage under the state predatory lending laws void the whole transaction, and the house is yours. Okay? Because it's been 90 days, and the banks have 90 days, 60 days from the origination of the loan to discover fraud in the loan. And there's fraud in there that the banks put in that you're not aware of, but I'm aware of it, and the banks are aware of it. And so the banks had an obligation to go in there and discover the fraud and fix it. They didn't do it. So that means the mortgage is yours. The 90 days is passed. So it wasn't 60 days, it's 90 days. I'm sorry, and it's right before me too. I must be blind. 90 days. So ambiguity in a contract is to be construed against the drafter. The mortgage purchase agreement clearly states that after the discovery of the breach of the warranties and representation of the responsible party, the party discovering the breach or misrepresentation must notify the responsible party. And while the agreement boldly states that if after 90 days have passed after the discovery of the breach and our warranties and representation, and if the responsible party does not take possession of the affected mortgage, that the purchaser seller must delete the affected loan from the trust and have nothing else to do with it. The agreement remains deadly silent on what is to become of the collateral security vote instrument and who is to take ownership. So people, what I said to you, all right, the investor have 90 days after he purchased the mortgage from the bank. The bank give us the loan. The bank sell the loan to the investor. The investor have 90 days after the sale to check the documents and make sure there's no fraud. No, because the investor was in with the fraud, he didn't check the documents. So he's committing fraud ourselves. So after 90 days, these people don't discover the fraud and notify it, and they must notify the bank. They have to delete the mortgage from the account. I have nothing to do with it. Which means that you don't have to pay them scrap because they're not entitled to collect the payment. People under their own law, they have to delete this loan from the account and have nothing else to do with it. Which means they cannot collect any payments from you. So when they collect the payment, they're committing fraud. So stop paying your mortgage payment. Force them into trying to foreclose on you. Then get the security agreement and you will see for yourself that they cannot foreclose on you because they don't have the authority if the house is yours. So anyway, I threaten them with this lawsuit and I tell them that I will give this information to the American people. And so they call it a threat, intimidation. Because people, the agreement doesn't say who get the house. It gotta be the homeowner, because the bank ain't allowed to have anything to do with it at all. It's the homeowner's home now. So they're trying to stop Paul Mucker from telling you all this stuff. Ambiguity in a contract is to be construed against the drafter. Who drafted the agreement? The banks and the investors together. So because the contract doesn't say who gets the home, it's ambiguous. Therefore, it should go against the drafter, which are the banks, so which many homeowners get to keep the home. In light of the fact that the parties must adhere to their language in the agreement and that the 90 days period to execute its provision have long since expired, the parties have failed to prosecute the agreement of their contract, failed to enforce the agreement among themselves, have satisfied the debt, as they must delete the mortgage out of existence. This being so, as it is must be, the deletion of the security instrument from the trust and having nothing else to do with it can be legally considered abandoning the collateral securing the debt. Once a responsible party fails to take delivery of the security instrument within the 90 days allotted period, the instrument must be voided out of existence. So that what this means is that once a transaction has been voided, it can never be reported to have ever existed. So that means that the note holder cannot attempt to enforce a void financial security instrument against the homeowner, who incidentally was not made a party to the agreement, unless that note holder wants the FBI to come calling with 18 U.S.C. section 1010. So people, the FBI, the U.S. government have a section, a law against fraud, because once there's fraud in the loan applications and the mortgage document, and 90 days pass and the investor didn't find this fraud, and even if he found it and the bank didn't take this loan back from the investor, they have to delete it and they cannot collect any mortgage in it. So when they come and send your mortgage payment, they're committing fraud. They are illegally enforcing a void instrument. So therefore, under 18 U.S.C. section 1010, it's called mortgage fraud. Okay, I'm not going to read it, but y'all should look it up. It's a very powerful law. Powerful. But they're not using it. On September 15, 2008, when the market crashed, the entire world discovered that everyone in America whose home loan was pooled and secured with other mortgages were riddled with fraud and misrepresentation. Therefore, the purchaser note holder cannot normally go after a consumer and attempt to enforce the agreement against the consumer when the consumer was not even made aware of or made a party to the clandestine-like agreement. So what all this means is that if any American resident have a home mortgage loan that has been securitized, and that loan is in default or has already been defaulted and are foreclosed upon, and the service a purchaser is served with allegation that the responsible party committed fraud and a misrepresentation of warranties. Then the responsible party, the purchaser, the seller, the servicer, and perhaps even importantly, the foreclosure attorneys owe the consumer 3 times the amount of his loss in accordance with the provisions of the Federal Trade Commission Act and State Unfair and Deceptive Practice Act. So which means, people, if your home was worth $300,000 and you lost it, they owe you $900,000. Under the FDIC, the Federal Trade Commission Act, and your State Unfair and Deceptive Practice Act, if you lost your home. I even said they're foreclosed on you. They had to pay 3 times the value of your loss. Okay? And this is why they prosecuted Paul Merkel, because Paul Merkel threatened them that I'm going to share this with you all. Let them intent to sue. I am driving home the point, going in for the kill, striking the hammer while the iron is still hot, pulling out the grandest heist of them all. 90 days have passed since I have notified all of the respondents about the responsible party's breaches, misrepresentation of warranties and fraud. 90 days have passed in which the respondents have had to delete the security instrument from the trust. 90 days have passed in which the responsible party had to reclaim the collateral security the council deleted mortgage. Wherefore, in this type of scenario as is present, who gets the collateral when the security directly tying it to the note holder must be undeniably void by the deletion, by deleting it from after books of the ones charged with collecting the debt? What are the homeowner's right to be secured in his or her own home? He, she was never made a party to the transaction to hack the fraudulent security instrument attached to the collateral. Nor did he, she agree to the terms of the mortgage purchase agreement between the Sly Fox and his fat cat friends. So where does he, she stand in this type of dilemma? Is he, she to stand idle while allowing the Sly Fox to have his cake and eat it too, and at the same time sending in the vulture friends to come in and tear up all the remaining flesh, and not even tossing our children in the bones, while the fat cat and Wall Street sit on their perches sipping on champagne as the weasel, you know, those unscrupulous ones, poke toothpicks in their mouth and laughing at us as they pick the remaining flesh from out of their decay? The agreement is to remain silent on the matter. And though I have searched exasperatingly, I have found no law, neither state nor federal, which addresses the issue. The government remains silent on this also. No one was prepared for this occasion when parties left unregulated in their own devices and involving American family home would one day fail to adhere to the rules which they themselves wrote and agreed to abide by. Ambiguity in a contract is to be construed against the drafter. Okay? So what that means, people, is that when the drafter of a contract fail to specify things in a contract, okay, the people, okay, now, because the state too has been complicit and derelict in their duty to regulate the respondent, the state can lay no claim to the collateral, securing the debt. So what I'm saying, people, the state can't take these homes because the state was a part of the fraud. So then my question to the 300 million American residents who have been affected by Wall Street defrauding other people and then turning around and stealing our national treasures through the people's taxes. Does this mean... Hold up, big jump. Does this mean that about 10 million American homeowners can... Now, as of this day, have a United States of America constitutional right to identify and claim, reclaim, confiscate, hijack from the home free and clear of any incumbents from the property note holder. Checkmate. So you see people, okay, that's part of the threat that they're going to bring before a jury. Anyway, my people, that's enough for now. I'm tired. I'll show you all some other time, okay? So what do you all think? Let me know. Show me you all, you know, what you all think about this evidence that these people gonna put before a jury to convict me on terror charges of intimidation of witness, harassment, threats to kill, wiretapping, intimidation of witness. And remember, these charges have to be like I intentionally intended to harm them or to force them into doing something, like to intimidate them into doing something to cause, and it was really intent to cause bodily harm or injury or put them in fear of their life or emotional distress. You have to be that. Those have to be elements of the crime. Okay, so I'm out. One love, one heart, one destiny to all those who seek justice. Because Paul Michael, I'm seeking justice. People, it don't matter to me if they dismiss this case or not. With this kind of evidence, if this is what they're gonna bring before jury, bring it on. I'm gonna have a feeling. Foxes will be left in the ditches to get slaughtered, while the weasels try to weasel their way out of it. Okay, all right. One.